What is school choice? It's not as complicated as you might think. School choice is a way governments can give parents back their education tax dollars to choose whatever educational options they think best fit their kids. Here's how it works. It starts with you and your community. Together, you all pay income taxes, sales taxes, or both. Those taxes become the revenue the state uses to pay for education. From there, the state splits up those funds to all families based on their children's needs. Families can then use that money to purchase whichever schooling options, public, private, charter, homeschool, online, or otherwise, they think are best for their kids. An educated child has greater opportunities to succeed and to bring that success back to their community. Like to know how school choice looks today? Although it is not available to all families right now, there are four ways many states offer parents choice.
That is kind of an intro to EdChoice's website, and you can definitely talk to them even further, but that leads us to our thing. So let's give them a warm welcome. How about that? Both of you, everybody is concerned about education these days. Everybody's thinking about how we can do this better. What are some options out there? I don't know one person I've ever spoken to that has either kids, grandkids, nieces, nephews, cousins, whatever they think, congregation kids that are there in their churches that are not thinking about how we can improve healthcare. Some of our communities are hard hit, and the options just aren't there. And I'll start with myself. Because I got a question. You know, in out here in the Maryland area, we live in, it's called Prince George's County, and it says, one of the most affluent African-American neighborhoods or, counties in the country, which it is per capita. Mm-hmm. At the same time, it's hard to send your kids to those schools because they're some of the most worst performing schools out there. Mm-hmm. No competition. You got to send the kids across county or either to private schools to give them a real square up opportunity. What do you guys think about that? Either one can start off, and I think that might be a good one for Leslie, perhaps.
Thank you. I'm happy to address that issue, and I'm very pleased to be with all of you today. Thanks so much for this opportunity to share some ideas and some information. At EdChoice, we believe that every child in America, every child should have the opportunity to attend the school or receive the educational options that the parents decide, the parents believe, are right for that child. Now, in Prince George's County, if that system was in place, where in fact every parent would have control over the funding that the state has already appropriated for that child's education, if the parent could direct that funding and direct the education of that child to any educational resource, you wouldn't have the problem that you just described. You just wouldn't have that problem. Parents would have the freedom to be able to send their kids where they need to go to school. And this is what we advocate. This is what we try to teach people about. There is a method of funding education that allows for that to happen. It was first created by Dr. Milton Friedman. Our task is to carry forward his intellectual legacy. He came up with this idea of funding formula for education back in 1955. So This is not a radical new idea, mind you. And it's been perfected over time, and now there are many versions of that original voucher idea. But at the core, what it does is it puts the power of that education funding into the hands of parents so they can make their own decisions about what's right for their own children.
Wow, that's really interesting. Help me understand why, if education is this simple, Gerard, and you say, we should do this voucher side. I mean, you've experienced down in Florida quite a bit in terms of, does this stuff work? Does it not work? Or help us understand that a little bit. What models have you seen?
Well, first of all, thank you for extending to me an invitation to speak to you, particularly faith leaders. Number two, let me thank Star Parker for her tireless work in keeping the issue of reform and urban communities beforehand. I grew up in Los Angeles, California, and I know about her story, and so it's always good to have California leanings. So two things to consider. When you look at the fact that education in 41 states is the number one line item in a governor's budget, or number two in the remaining, it shows you that we have money in the school system, billions of dollars. In fact, we spend $355 billion on education, state, local, federal. That's number one. Number two, when you mention do vouchers work, the research is pretty clear. There's a professor at the University of Arkansas named Dr. Pat Wolf. He has studied vouchers more than anyone else in the United States, including the DC voucher program. We sit in a city with one of five, quote-unquote, urban-based voucher programs in the nation. The DC voucher program is the most studied federal program via DOE in history. So when people tell you there's no research, let me just get to the point. They're lying. When they tell you that it doesn't work, they're misguided. And when they tell you that we don't need vouchers because we shouldn't use public money to pay for education at religious schools, they don't understand American history.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
The 1965 Elementary and Secondary Education Act, which has driven much of education in the United States, allows Title I money, which is used for low-income kids, to go to private schools, mm-hmm. Catholic, non-Catholic, and other. Teachers at private schools today in the United States receive Title II funding, federal money to support private school professional development. So vouchers work. Do we have challenges? Absolutely. Are there some schools that have done some horrible things with money? Absolutely. But that's not enough to get rid of the program.
Wow. Boy, there's so much I could touch on there. Let me ask you, maybe put this one on the table real quick, and either one of you could take this one, and probably both of you might want to take this one, is this. As you're talking, I'm sitting here thinking, hey, shouldn't we just trust the NEA, National Education, I mean, the Teachers Association and the guys like that and the Teachers Union. No. I mean, aren't they working for our best interests?
No.
And there was a pause.
Okay. No, I'm happy to jump in on this one. I'm sure Gerard will be
right with
me. I
hope I didn't stun my panelists over here.
Ladies
good.
First.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm also an attorney. And so I've been deeply involved in a lot of the litigation concerning school choice programs across the country. So inevitably, it's the NEA, the National Teachers Union, the AFT, the other National Teachers Union. They're the ones who will go after these programs that empower parents to make their own decisions about their kids' education.
Oh, you say go after the programs?
Yes, let me give you... today's favorite example. At yeah. any point in time, any year, I can give you examples that are absolutely deplorable about the actions of our nation's teachers' unions against parents and kids in our states. But the one that really gets to me right now is the lawsuit that is going on in the state of Florida. Mm-hmm. So in the state of Florida, Florida has been very successful with their school choice programs. They have a very vigorous tax credit scholarship program. They have a new education savings account that's for kids with special needs. They have a voucher that is specifically for kids with special needs. And this year, they have almost 100,000 children who are now accessing different educational opportunities that work for them through these various school choice programs. So these programs that have been around for a while, the ESA is the newest one, but they've been around for a while. Now, typically, the teachers union will step in right after there's legislation that's been passed for some new program, and they're going to launch in, they're going to try to stop it in its infancy. But they didn't do that in Florida with this big tax credit scholarship program or with the ESA. Or with the voucher for kids with special needs until now. So now we are 10 years into the program, and now 100,000 children are at risk of losing their education that is working for them, because the teachers' union doesn't really like it and believes truly that every child in America should be compelled to attend a public school. That's their bottom line. Now, parents, obviously, the parents of 100,000 children in Florida strongly disagree with that position. So when you ask me, should we trust them? No. No, gotcha. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Now, given that this is a group of faith leaders, I also need to share with you this story about Randy Weingarten, who's the head of the American Federation for Teachers. A couple years ago, at a conference of the Education Writers Association, this is a group of journalists across the country who write about education, all the papers, big and small, they attend. And when she was speaking, she was asked about these private schools and these religious schools. And why is it that she seems to be so opposed to kids going to these religious schools? And her response went like this. Well, you know, they teach creationism, and, well, we all know those are just stories. It's not science. That's not real. They're just stories. And that just shouldn't be in our schools. So, obviously, that line stuck with me, and probably will for the rest of my life. I was so appalled by that statement, but that was actually a very truthful statement on her part on what she actually believes as the leader of that organization.
Wow. I'm going to let Mr. Robinson over here maybe address that as well.
So for me, the dichotomy for me isn't do I trust the teachers' union. The question is, do I trust parents, and do I trust them with money to do the right thing? I also want us to remember that the teachers' union is in the business to take care of its members.
That's right.
Like a lot of people who are members of unions. I grew up in a union home. My stepdad worked for 47 years for Lockheed before it became Lockheed Martin. I worked 3 years for a union. I understand the role of unions. And so for me, the teachers' union, they have a job to do. They also have to protect what they call their jobs and their interests. The public school system helped to create the black middle class. And so when we talk about school reform, we have to keep that in mind. In fact, it was 1966 when the Black Teachers Association merged with what was then NEA, which began in 1857 to create the modern NEA. And so conversations with me, I can't separate black history, black labor, politics, and education without talking about that in choice. But here's what I will say. When they go against vouchers, as they have in California, when there was a voucher initiative in 93 and 2000, and in Michigan, when they go against the voucher program in DC, when they went against the voucher program that went to the Supreme Court from Cleveland, I understand it. They've got political interests to serve. I won't say that they hate kids. A lot of teachers got into this work to help kids, but we understand politics. So I draw a fine line between union politics and people. I expect them to do what they have to do. But here's what you have to do as faith leaders, is to entrust people with information that you're getting from us. But more importantly, we need prayer. Because there's only going to come a point where you're not going to be moved by words, you're not going to be moved by research, you're not going to be ruled by data. The people only got bold when they got the Spirit. And we are only going to get bold for school reform when we get the Spirit. And that's the role you can play.
That's something else. I try to not reflect too deeply on when we were fighting on, and I was engaged in fighting on key marriage initiative in the state of Maryland, and I never forget, we're working hard trying to raise money, and then next thing I see, $100,000 from the National Education Association given to not supporting marriage. Then Teachers Association, another $150,000. And they began to just, and across the country, you saw these contributions into these unique campaigns that you thought, what does that have to do with education and why would they be involved in that? Do you all know that or why are they involved in those kinds of things? I'm not sure.
Well,
go ahead.
We're the nation's capital, and money is what greases the will. Mm-hmm. Now, when people say that teacher unions don't have money, again, that's just simply not true. Between 1990 and 2013, the NEA and the AST combined spent $163 million. $163 million supporting campaigns primarily for federal lawmakers, PACs, and otherwise. That's more money than Merrill Lynch, wow, Goldman Sachs, and some other Fortune 500s combined. That's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, U.S. News and World Report put out a list of, I think, the top 153 givers to the current presidential campaign, primarily PAC money, let's say. Of the 153 groups, families, others who've given money, and they account for about almost two-thirds of all the money, number six is the teachers union. Mm. Number six. And that's behind individuals. So in protecting their members, in protecting their interest, and in marketing their ideas, they're doing what all of us should do. Rally your economics, rally the people around an idea, and make a move. It may be different than what we have, but rather than hate, let's create a pact that you guys have to influence those decisions as well.
Mm. Wow. That's really good. I just got to ask one other question. I'm sorry, and I don't mean to stay right here for a minute, because I just heard, and this is switching a little bit from the teachers union. Not too long ago, there was an article out there about Florida, and I don't know why Florida's in the spotlight in this conversation so much, but NAACP, they said, hey, we're going to stop pushing and try to really, I guess, tell folks not to be pushing any school choice initiatives and those kinds of things. Why did they get involved in this issue, and what do you know about that?
The NAACP has been actually of some great interest to me, because there have been certain individual chapters of the NAACP that have been publicly supportive of school choice. There's one in New Jersey in particular. I think it was several years ago. They had just been given the award of one of the best chapters in the country, and then announced that they were strongly in favor of vouchers and school choice. I don't know if they lost the award after they made that announcement, but I know it was a question. But the national position, though, of the NAACP has been solidly against any type of school choice. Now, previously, they had supported charter schools, but just recently, though, they've come out against charter schools as well. So they have taken a position that seems to be very much at odds with other national black organizations that have been really excellent to work with. We've worked with the Urban League, with 100 Black Men of America, with BAYO, where Gerard was a former president of the Black Alliance for Educational Options. So the NAACP has positioned itself a bit as an outlier from other black organizations across the country.
If you go to my AEI webpage, Gerard Robinson, I publish a three-part series on the NAACP and charter schools, just to go through the history. The first one, I start off by saying, there's no organization in the United States better suited to have a conversation about the real meaning of public education than the NAACP.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Now, I, as a black man who was Secretary of Education in Florida and Virginia, would have never had that position were it not for the NAACP and all the workers and the Legal Defense Fund, who played a role as well. I'm clear about that. When they make a decision to say we're against charter schools and vouchers, I could understand historically why they're against it. Now, how many Southerners do we have in the room? Show of hands. How many of you remember what it was like or heard stories of Mom, Big Mama, or somebody else when the Supreme Court decision in 54 and 55 was rendered with Brown to basically tell Jim Crow to go to the back of the classroom? Southern states, I live in Virginia with one of the big ones, Southern states responded through massive resistance, and they did a number of things. They closed public schools, got rid of black principals in schools. They used public money called tuition grants and gave those to white families who went to segregated white academies, some of them still existing today. And that was called school choice or freedom of choice. Mm-hmm. And so I have to tell some young people, There was a point when freedom of choice had a very negative connotation. Mm-hmm. It's what I call fear-based freedom of choice.
Right.
It was to make sure there was no integration, and it was to make sure that Jim Crow stayed in the front of the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
From 1990 moving forward, particularly with the role of faith-based leaders, we are now in what I call the liberty-based freedom of choice movement.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it's not discrimination, but education is the main focus. And so I understand their position. I happen to have a different one. They can afford to be wrong on this one, but they can also afford to be wrong, and we all can sit in this room today and afford to have this conversation because of NAACP. But on this one, we're just on different sides of the fence.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, wow, right. That's interesting.
Right.
It sounds like it's much like a little bit about the states' rights argument from the past as well, when it carried a negative connotation, but really, you know, states should have ability now, more from a liberty perspective, into choosing what's best for their citizens. So that's a good perspective.
If I might also, I think one of the biggest differences between the days of Brown versus Board of Education and today is exactly what you described. During those days, parents in the black community did not have a lot of power.
Right.
But that's not the situation today. Today, we see the strongest support for educational options is from parents in the black community, and particularly from the poorest parents, are the most supportive of educational choice for every child in America.
Wow.
And not only that, but boy, if you ever want to have a really great experience, you talk to one of the moms who has accessed a voucher for her child, and suddenly, as I was told by one of the moms here in DC, the question was put to her that the school that she had elected to send her child to, the private school, was not performing well academically. And so didn't that mean that that voucher should be taken away from her and she should be compelled to send her child to the public school that was also a failing school? But shouldn't that happen? That was the question put to her. And she fired up, as a mother could do, and said, look, here's the difference. When she sent her child to the public school, she didn't know if her child would come home.
Mm.
Any day of the week, she didn't know when the child left if that child would ever come home. But by sending her child to this faith-based private school, she knew her child was coming home at the end of the day. She knew it. She said, you try to take that voucher out of these hands, and I will fight you with everything that I am, because my child matters to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's it.
Well, that's a great perspective, and that's almost a great segue, because my next question was really, I know you all know very specifically, help us understand about the improvements that come in the child's life, how they achieve, how they excel. Give me some, can you tell us some stories about that side of it? And because, you know, we know there's political drama with it, but really, how does this affect the life of the child?
So the modern school choice movement in the private sector started in 1990 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Today you have over, you know, close to 30,000 kids in the voucher program. There was one school started by 7 African-American pastors who realized two things. They said, number one, most of the kids who are taking advantage of the voucher program are going to Catholic and Lutheran schools. None of them are Catholic or Lutheran.
Right.
Number two, some of us have really, really small schools, but what if we decide to come together and have one really big school? And so they created something called CEO Academy, Clergy for Educational Options.
Wow.
Now we'll see if this joke goes over well other places. I said the miracle wasn't the fact that you had the school open. The miracle was the fact that 7 black pastors got together and agreed on one thing. That went over okay here. I get bigger laughs in a different crowd, but I won't go there. But they got together and opened the school. To qualify for the school at this time, you pretty much had to be low income, 185% of poverty or less. The school within a five-year time period had a 95% college-going rate.
Wow.
Now, poor, quote-unquote, black, male, female, from the neighborhood, all the issues, whatever you say, same issues. Five, six, seven blocks, different school, same kids, different results. That school converted to a charter school, still in existence today. Three of those students are at Howard University as we speak. In fact, that's my alma mater where my oldest daughter graduated this summer. You now, in one generation, one faith-based school changed the trajectory of 15 upcoming generations, breaking the cycle of poverty because you finished high school.
Wow.
That's one of many examples. And all of you can do the same thing. And if you don't have it, talk to us. We'll work to help you get it.
That's right. Man. Wow. Go right ahead, Leslie.
Okay. So I really have to jump in on this. I've been advocating for school choice for, this is my 30th year now. As I had mentioned, I'm an attorney. And it was 30 years ago that I had a parent who walked in the office with her daughter and said she needed help. She and her husband had divorced, but her child had always gone to their little faith-based school. It was a school that was run by their church. Wasn't a real big school, but it was good. Daughter was doing well. She was about to enter high school, and the ex-husband, the father, decided, well, he didn't like that church anymore. He had split with the church, and he left, didn't want his daughter to go to that church's school anymore. The mother said, much like the story about the D.C. mom I just shared, with these hands, I promise you, my child is going to continue to go to my church's school. So we went to court. We had a five-day trial. 5 days. And the only question on the table was this. Who is the appropriate person or entity to decide where a child goes to school? Who should make that decision?
Mm-hmm.
5 days. On the fifth day, 3:30 in the afternoon, got our decision. And we won. I was very excited. I also just happened to beat a trial attorney who in 10 years had not lost a case. And I was just a young lawyer at that point. I didn't have any kids. I didn't go to private schools. I didn't know anything about private schools. I knew very little about kids. I had just been married. I mean, I didn't know a lot about any of this prior to this case. So I was feeling pretty good. Went home that afternoon and decided I'd put my feet up and watch the evening news, see what was happening, have a nice glass of wine. And so I did. First story that came up. Breaking news story. That afternoon at a local high school, when the kids were leaving school, getting on the buses to go home, there's an argument, and the kids started shooting at each other. And at that moment, as 30 years later, I still get goosebumps over that moment, I realized everything that mother had told me about how important it was that she make the decision of what happens to her child. It was all true because that was the school that girl would have gone to the very next day had I lost that case.
Wow.
So that was my epiphany. That was my epiphany. And 30 years later, I'm still advocating for this. So in 30 years' time, I have seen a lot of children. I have met a lot of parents. And as Gerard said, you know, we think first about these kids who are in desperate situations, and we see their lives changed. Literally, they go from a life of failure where their lives are in danger, literally, to learning the joy of learning and thriving and building a life for themselves. But there's more. There was a little boy who I met at 10 years old who told me, "Miss Heiner, Everybody hates me. I don't have any friends. My teachers hate me. I've never gotten a D, more than a D, and my teacher told me when I got a D that that was a gift, that I should have gotten an F, but I got so many Fs that she gave me a D because she pitied me. My mother hates me, and I hadn't seen her for a long time, and I don't know who my dad is. And he was living with his grandmother, who just hated this child. But she was trying to get this child, her grandson, into another school outside of the public schools because every day, he told me, every day I get in trouble and they kick me out of school. Grandma has to come pick me up and she's really mad at me and she keeps losing her job. So the motivation for the grandma was just to be able to keep her job, get the kid into a place where she wouldn't have to go pick him up every day. Well, lo and behold, he got into a wonderful little school and he was valued there. That's the key.
Yeah.
This is what we find in faith-based schools, that life is valued. That's the key. When a child knows that his life is valued, learning comes, and it comes easily at that point. So a couple years later, talk to this little boy again. Guess what? Well, Grandma was attending the adult literacy classes that the school offered after hours. Because he kept coming home reading books to her. And she said, well, geez, maybe I should learn how to read. So she was learning how to read. And right after that happened, the two of them went to downtown Indianapolis, where the mother was living, homeless, found her, got her into a rehab facility. She was coming back, and she was also enrolled in the adult literacy class.
Wow.
So everything gets lifted up. In a family, think about your own family. If one family member is struggling, everybody struggles. You want to lift up each other. And this is what happens when parents have this opportunity to just take care of their kids.
This is so good. I want to ask one more question, then, and then I'm going to let you guys really challenge us for a couple moments. But Gerard, you mentioned the CEO school. Can you tell me, I mean, if folks are saying, hey, how do I build that consortium? How can I create a school? Some look at it as a daunting task and say, well, you know, I'm thinking about budget issues on so many other items. Mm-hmm. How do you see that coming together? What would you advise and how would you kind of help us understand what to do?
This is the right group because if you had to know everything in advance of a daunting task, you likely wouldn't have accepted the calling. Consider this an extension of the calling. Five things to do. Number one, create a 501c3 with the number of people or yourself, just so you can at least get the tax paperwork together. Number two is to submit grants to organizations like the Walton Family Foundation, who provides anywhere from $50,000 up to $300,000 as a planning grant to start a school. Number three is to decide really quickly, do you want an elementary school, middle school, or high school? And those all have different benefits and challenges that come along. Fourth is to identify three buildings, likely ones that are up to school code. Some of you have churches, they're up to code for you to have adults, but you would actually have to change some things to make them code for schools. The schools and other people can help you with that. So make sure three buildings that are up to code. And last, give yourself a 3-year window. Start now, plan, except for a few things to fall through. But during a 3-year planning period, make sure you're beginning to talk. One thing I did with pastors is I had they supported something called Education Sunday. And Education Sunday is when a faith leader like yourself would dedicate an entire sermon just to education. And before he or she concluded, with 5 minutes, they would bring me up and say, this is Gerard Robinson. I work at that time for the Black Alliance for Educational Options. We have a table in the back. If you want to learn more about education, come to the back. People would sign our sheet. We would then come to the church the following Saturday, put on a 2-hour workshop to kind of do some of the things that we're doing. Something like that would help. There are people who, and my email address is Gerard, G-E-R-A-R-D dot Robinson. at AEI.org. There are people who are in the business of helping churches and faith-based leaders start schools. I can introduce you to people. Or send the information to CURE and they can make some contacts.
Yeah, we'll make sure you get that. Yeah. If you're interested, we'll make sure you get that information out. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. That's really good. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Sure.
And I love the perspective of a 3-year window, because sometimes when you talk about things, mm-hmm. you say, man, I need to get this done next year or a couple of months from now, whatever else. But this is really a marathon we're in. It's not a sprint. It's not a quick race. It's a marathon mm-hmm. that can affect generations. And I appreciate that 3-year window perspective. I think that might give some of us a chance to breathe.
Good.
Leslie, what would you tell us as we are looking at kind of transitioning out of this panel, but I'd love to hear, what would your encouragement to this audience be? What would you say are some of the key things that they could focus on? And I know we just talked about perhaps doing a school, but from the world of choice and how do they get it maybe involved in their area or get some things going, what would you say is they need to do?
Well, there's a lot of good news in the school choice world to share. As I shared in the beginning, when Milton Friedman came up with a formula for funding education so that we could allow for this, that was 1955. 1990, we had the first voucher, so that was a long period of time. And things went pretty slowly. I mean, your comment about this being a marathon is for real. But I will tell you this, that in 2011, something happened across the country. It was almost like everyone woke up and realized their own power. Because since 2011, we have had such growth in educational choice across the country that I find myself pinching myself each year and wondering if this is going to really continue, and it is continuing. So we now are up to 62 different types of school choice programs
Wow.
across the country in 29 states plus DC. And for this next year, at least half the country, those that don't have school choice now, they're trying to figure out how they can get it. And those states that already have it, they're trying to figure out how they can expand it, how they can serve more kids. So now is the time. Now is the time for real action. Now, the best way to do this, let me start with the simplest thing to do, which I also think is the most powerful. When you leave today, we're all going to go home to our homes. We're all going to see our neighbors. Talk to your neighbors. Mm. Tell your neighbors everything you learned here. Share your stories, share your information, and then ask your neighbors to share what you shared with their network of people. Share in your churches. Share with everybody you can think of. Share with somebody that you're sitting down, you're waiting for a bus, and bus is late, and you reach out to the next person, and you start talking about it. I do this all the time. All the time. I don't know a stranger. We're always talking about school choice. But that's where the power is. The power is when we communicate directly with each other and we share what we know, that's where it is. Now, when we come together, this is the next step. When we come together, that power just continues to multiply. So in all of your states, you will find that there are groups of people who are doing just that. So I can help you with this at EdChoice. We get the phone calls from people across the country asking for help. Can you help us figure out how to bring people together, how to do a coalition? Can you teach us things? Can you teach us things so that we can then teach others?
Yeah.
We do this all the time. And that's really the good news to share, that there are so many people across the country who have engaged. You know, I there was a comment made by Dr. Martin Luther King when he was 38 years old that has always kind of stuck with me. Now, I should say that when Dr. King was assassinated, I was 10 years old, but I was precocious, as you should come as no surprise, right? But I remember this, and I came across a quote recently, and he said that for any one of us, at some point in our lives, we will have that moment when there is a mission, there is a cause, there is an injustice, there is something that is put in front of us. And it is ours to decide, are we going to act or are we not? And he said, we might not act because we might be afraid to act. Mm-hmm. We might be afraid that we'll lose our popularity. Someone may bomb our house.
That's really good.
We may be beaten for taking these positions. But, he said, if we fail to act, when God has placed the mission in front of us, and we fail to act, we may live to be 90 years old, but we will be just as dead at 38 years old, because that is a death of the spirit.
Wow.
And that drives me. This is a mission. I tell everybody, I don't really have a job. I mean, I do get paid, but I don't really have a job because this is not a job. This is a true life's mission that I will be engaged in until my last breath. And I encourage each of you to do the same thing. It's here, it's now. And children and parents so desperately need this help.
Wow.
Now's the time. And we can do it. And that's your good news. And we can do this. We know how.
Wow, that's amazing.
There's an answer.
That's something else. Gerard, final thoughts?
Final thoughts. Solomon reminds us in the book of Ecclesiastes that there's nothing new under the sun. And so when you hear the term school choice, that's just code word for what we've done for over 200 years. School choice doesn't mean private school versus public school. It means that if you want to go to a public school, let's make sure those schools work. That's a choice. If you can move, that's a choice. So no bifurcation. All schools should work. But also realize from an inspirational standpoint, what we call school choice today, during the 50s was a push for desegregation, but realize that what we're ultimately talking about is what the black church has been about since we arrived, and that's liberation. Following the Civil War, it was the newly freed Africans in the Southern legislatures who created the first universal free public school in America. When the founding generation was in Philadelphia in the 1780s debating the Constitution, Absalom Jones, other faith leaders, were talking about creating church-based schools before we had a Constitution. And when we arrived in Virginia, probably 1630s with chattel slavery, you can look and see even then there was a push for freedom. So what we call school choice is really liberty, liberation, and empowering people. And none of this would have happened in many ways without the black church. And so keep up the good work.
Wow. Man, this is a fact. It was really good. I've enjoyed this myself. I want to, as I get this question, I'm going to ask Pastor Yule over here that has a question. But Pastor Yule, I need you to be nice and loud for me.
Derek, one of the most frightening things, I think this is loud enough, one of the most frightening things about the NEA, when you read the history, the chronology of the NEA, John Dewey, the father of modern education, one of the most frightening things about these people were they were dedicated to separating your kids from their Christian faith.
Right.
When you read the founding documents of the NEA, one of the main things in their endeavor was to separate children from their parents and their Christian faith.
Right.
John Dewey, the father of modern education, an atheist, one of his great tenets was separate the kids from the faith. So when our teachers are trained to come from that perspective, and this should be important to all of us, that these folks, the NEA, in its founding documents, of the chronology of the NEA, in their founding documents, that one of the main things that it was dedicated to is separating the children from the faith of their parents. That's right. DJ can't have to go through the list of books. But I think that so much should be part of this conversation.
Appreciate that. Thank you so much. That's so true. Let me ask a couple questions here. How does a parent who homeschools their kids, kind of fit into this model, and whether public or private, homeschool, can they get any tax credits to provide for their child or anything like that?
Oh, homeschoolers have a very unique circumstance. Homeschoolers across the country, in some states, they have a lot of freedom. In other states, they don't have so much. In Oklahoma, for example, homeschooling is protected in their state constitution. In Nevada, homeschoolers have a great amount of freedom, but in some other states, not so much. So every time educational choice comes to town, the question about how this will impact homeschoolers is always very significant. Typically, people who do homeschool, they place a lot of value on that, and they're not going to give that up. Now, what we've found is that some homeschoolers just really want to be left alone. Mm-hmm. Just, we're good. Don't need to do anything with anybody else's money or anything. We're good. So we will fashion a law like we did in Nevada for their education savings account that specifically creates an exemption. So if you're homeschooling there, you're homeschooling, you don't want anybody to bother you, that's good. Nothing changes there. If you are homeschooling, or if you want to homeschool, but you want to participate in the education savings account, so you do want to use some of the state funding to pay for curriculum, for example, you can do that also. So it's a very important thing to us that, again, no matter what the parent chooses, if a parent chooses to send their child to a public school, magnet school, charter school, private school, do their own homeschooling, whatever they choose, that's good. So let's make sure that we protect the rights of those parents to make their own decisions about their kids. And so that's what we do with homeschooling, whether they want in or they want out, we can fashion that either way, or both.
They have a choice.
That's right.
That's good. Let me ask you this question, Gerard. What are the other barriers, perhaps, that are out there to educational alternatives, such as, you know, from K to 12 and home education? But what are some maybe the other barriers that are out there? I know we talked about a few.
One is transportation. So in Milwaukee, 25-year-old voucher program, during the early years, there was no money put aside for you for transportation to school. So that was a big one. In some places, if you live in a large county system, you may not have a great bus system. You know, choice works well in D.C. and New York in part because they actually have subways. You haven't seen a subway in Memphis or Nashville. And so some of it's geography. Another barrier, frankly, is also funding. In the charter school sector, charter schools only receive 75 cents on the dollar. Mm-hmm. Most charter schools do not receive 100%. An exception would be a charter school that we have in Richmond, Virginia, where they receive 100%. But for the most part, they don't receive dollar for dollar. So there's also the gap you have to make up through philanthropic funding. And I think third, which is probably the largest, is just misinformation, the campaign mm-hmm. of misinformation that it doesn't work, it robs schools, your children are going to be illiterate, dot, dot, dot. So those are some of the factors. But you can change, besides the last one, you can change those things in law and regulation, but always push for money for transportation.
Wow, that's something else. You know, it's fascinating. I lived in Rochester, New York for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And really interesting, when we were sending our kids to school, they asked us, what school do they go to? Mm-hmm. And this is from the transportation side of it. They actually transported the kids to any school that was in the area. So if you were at a private school, that public transportation bus system, big old yellow bus, we called it the cheese bus. I don't know if y'all know that.
Yeah.
But you know, the big yellow bus actually would take them to the private school, which Correct. We had our kid in, versus the public, which was a really interesting system. And you wonder, man, I got from, you know, come from Maryland. I'm thinking, how does that work?
Right.
So let me ask you one last question here is, what about curriculums? I mean, how do curriculums play into this? And, you know, are the curriculums different? What about these crazy curriculums that some would say, man, these are really twisted curriculums that are being taught or trying to be pushed in our secular schools at times. But how can we maybe look at those, and how can maybe parents even opt out of those? Can they opt out? And if they're in choice schools, those kinds of things.
Well, that's a hot button issue. and actually, this is one of the things that at EdChoice, this is a priority for us, that anytime there is a school choice program that is enacted in any state, we want to make sure that there is no state regulation that creeps up to go into that little church school to have the state try to say what the curriculum should be. That just seems to defeat the purpose altogether of freedom of choice and freedom to educate kids as you think they should be educated. So we're careful about that. But the curriculum issue varies greatly from state to state. So let me give you an example of my home state of Indiana. Indiana is looked at as a really great state for educational choice and a really bad state for some regulations. So we get both. We have the largest voucher program in the country. But all of our private schools also, they all take the state test. And the state test, we opted out of Common Core, but our standards are pretty close to Common Core. And of course, you know, as we all know, whatever your standards are, your curriculum matches your test, you know, it all fits together. So this is an issue. But the issue for us, though, in Indiana, it was the private schools who actually asked to do this. So it was 35 years ago, I believe now. A couple things were happening. First is, at that time, the common wisdom in Indiana about private schools was that, yeah, they're not very good, those private schools. Nobody really knows them, and I don't know what kind of crazy things they do in these private schools. That was the common wisdom at the time. Yeah. The private schools got a little ticked off about that and said, well, we know if our kids take this stupid state test, they're going to do just fine. So they wanted to take the state test, just to show, hey, look, we have something good going on here. Then there was another incentive that they couldn't participate in any of the state athletic activities either without taking the state test. So the private schools decided, we don't really care about this dumb test yet. Let's do this. Kids can do sports, and we can show that we are great schools. So that was a long, long time ago that they opted to do that. Now, I don't think they'd opt to do that today. Mm-hmm. So in different states, you'll find where some states will want to impose the testing, which will drive curriculum, and others will not. Again, we err on the side of protecting the rights of the private school providers to do what they think is best. And frankly, we've also found that private schools tend to do their own testing, which is far, far better than anything the states have ever devised. Wow. So why not support that?
Well, thank you. Appreciate that. Well, let's give them a warm welcome. I mean, a warm thank you.